Simon & Schuster Audio presents Lincoln by David Herbert Donald, read by Dick Estell.
Dedication for Aida and Bruce, who have had to live with Lincoln for most of their lives. I claim not to have controlled events, but confess plainly that events have controlled me. Abraham Lincoln to Albert G. Hodges, April 4, 1864. Preface. The only time I ever met President John F. Kennedy, in February 1962, he was unhappy with historians. A group of scholars had been in the Oval Office, hoping to enlist him in a poll that ranked American presidents. I was not one of those visitors, but the next day, when I gave a talk in the White House about Abraham Lincoln, the subject was much on his mind. He voiced his deep dissatisfaction with the glib way the historians had rated some of his predecessors as below average, and marked a few as failures. Thinking no doubt of how his own administration would look in the backward glance of history, he resented the whole process. With real feeling, he said, no one has a right to grade a president, not even poor James Buchanan, who has not sat in his chair, examined the mail and information that came across his desk, and learned why he made his decisions. This book was conceived in the spirit of President Kennedy's observations. In tracing the life of Abraham Lincoln, I have asked at every stage of his career what he knew and when he had to take critical actions, how he evaluated the evidence before him, and why he reached his decisions. It is, then, a biography written from Lincoln's point of view, using the information and ideas that were available to him. It seeks to explain rather than to judge. My biography is based largely on Lincoln's own words, whether in his letters and messages or in conversations recorded by reliable witnesses. I have tried as far as possible to write from the original sources, that is, from first-hand contemporary accounts by people who saw and talked with the president. Of course, I have consulted the voluminous secondary literature, but I have used it chiefly for letters and documents that I could not find elsewhere. My approach was made possible by the availability of the Abraham Lincoln papers in the Library of Congress, now fortunately on microfilm. After use by Lincoln's authorized biographers, John G. Nicolay and John Hay, in 1890, these papers were sealed until 1947, and therefore could not be consulted for the major biographies by Albert J. Beveridge, William E. Barton, Carl Sandburg, and J.G. Randall. Author's footnote, this was true of the first two volumes of Randall's Lincoln the President, published in 1945. Professor Randall was able to make some use of the Lincoln papers in the third volume of that work, subtitled Midstream, published in 1952. Richard N. Current drew heavily on the Lincoln papers in completing the final volume, Last Full Measure, which appeared in 1955. But the basic structure and themes of Randall's magisterial work were selected before the Lincoln papers became available. Back to the text. The results of my inquiries can most readily be defined in negative terms. This book is not a general history of the United States during the middle of the 19th century. I have stuck close to Lincoln, who was only indirectly connected with the economic and social transformations of the period. It is not even a history of the Civil War. There is, for example, almost nothing in the following pages about the internal affairs of the Confederacy, because these were matters that Lincoln could not know about. It is not a military history. I have not described campaigns and battles that Lincoln did not witness. I have not offered a broad philosophical discussion of the origins of the Civil War, and I have not addressed the question of whether it was the first modern war. These are important subjects, but they did not present themselves to Abraham Lincoln in any practical way. I have not asked whether Lincoln freed the slaves or the slaves freed themselves, because Lincoln never considered these roads to emancipation as mutually exclusive. Certainly, he knew that thousands of slaves, in individual heroic acts of rebellion, were leaving their masters to seek freedom behind the Union lines. But he also knew that ending the institution of slavery required official action on the part of the United States government. In focusing closely on Lincoln himself, on what he knew, when he knew it, and why he made his decisions, I have, I think, produced a portrait rather different from that in other biographies. It is perhaps a bit more grainy than most, with more attention to his unquenchable ambition, to his brain-numbing labor in his law practice, to his tempestuous married life, and to his repeated defeats. It suggests how often chance or accident played a determining role in shaping his life, and it emphasizes his enormous capacity for growth, which enabled one of the least experienced and most poorly prepared men ever elected to high office to become the greatest American president. More important, this biography highlights a basic trait of character evident throughout Lincoln's life, the essential passivity of his nature. Lincoln himself recognized it in a letter he wrote on April 4, 1864, to Albert G. Hodges, a fellow Kentuckian, who asked him to explain why he had shifted from his inaugural pledge not to interfere with slavery to a policy of emancipation. After relating how circumstances had obliged him to change his mind, how emancipation and the use of African-American soldiers had become military necessities, the president concluded, "In telling this tale, I attempt no compliment to my own sagacity. I claim not to have controlled events, but confess plainly that events have controlled me." From his earliest days, Lincoln had a sense that his destiny was controlled by some larger force, some higher power. Turning away from Orthodox Christianity because of the emotional excesses of frontier evangelicalism, he found it easier as a young man to accept what was called the doctrine of necessity, which he defined as the belief that the human mind is impelled to action or held in rest by some power over which the mind itself has no control. Later, he frequently quoted to his partner William H. Herndon the lines from Hamlet, "There's a divinity that shapes our ends, rough-hew them how we will." From Lincoln's fatalism derived some of his most lovable traits, his compassion, his tolerance, his willingness to overlook mistakes. That belief did not, of course, lead him to lethargy or dissipation. Like thousands of Calvinists who believed in predestination, he worked indefatigably for a better world, for himself, for his family, and for his nation. But it helped to buffer the many reverses that he experienced and enabled him to continue a strenuous life of aspiration. It also made for a pragmatic approach to problems, a recognition that if one solution was fated not to work, another could be tried. "My policy is to have no policy," became a kind of motto for Lincoln, a motto that infuriated the sober, doctrinaire people around him who were inclined to think that the president had no principles either. He might have offended his critics less if he had more often used the analogy he gave James G. Blaine when explaining his course on Reconstruction. "The pilots on our western rivers steer from point to point, as they call it, setting the course of the boat no farther than they can see. And that is all I propose to myself in this great problem." Both statements suggest Lincoln's reluctance to take the initiative and make bold plans. He preferred to respond to the actions of others. They also show why Lincoln, in his own distinctively American way, had the quality John Keats defined as forming a man of achievement, that quality which Shakespeare possessed so enormously, negative capability, that is, when a man is capable of being in uncertainties, mysteries, doubts, without any irritable reaching after fact and reason. Much of the research for this biography was made possible through a generous grant from the Division of Research Programs of the National Endowment for the Humanities, grant number RO-2128-89. I am particularly indebted.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.